as a permanent fundraising technique, from communication material to donor reach out to webinars and sessions on how to succeed in efficient crowdfunding. NGO Plus is an incentive for all committed nonprofits to learn more and to acquire more knowledge. Today, we have devised a webinar on a very pressing and relatable topic, donor fatigue. We hope you benefit from this webinar and gather takeaways which will help you in your day-to-day activities and to manage donors, and which will also help you to mobilize the crowdfunding platform of Give India to your maximum benefit. So today, I, Nida, and my colleague Shravya will be hosting the webinar for your benefit. We will be taking questions towards the end of this webinar. So please do stay with us, and we hope you benefit from this webinar. Let us start this webinar by understanding what exactly is donor fatigue. In order to help you with this, we have developed a small sketch. In this sketch, my colleague Shravya will act as an NGO and I will act as a donor. Let us now see the interactions which follow.
Hello, our organization is raising funds to educate the girl child during the COVID-19 pandemic. Our operations span across Karnataka and aim to support 50,000 girls. We need your support to spread the word and fund this campaign. Would you be interested in donating to this campaign?
Oh, it's so great to hear about your campaign, but I'm so sorry. I've already donated to many COVID missions in the past months. And there are national charities and there are also state charities which have sought so many donations. And I just don't think I will be able to donate any more. So does this sound familiar to all of you? Has this happened to you before, where you've reached out to donors for donations for your causes, but they have said that they will not be able to donate? Have you seen a diminishing and declining donations? Do let us know. In order to understand whether you have faced the situation, we have created a poll here to make this session more interactive and to understand your thoughts. So let's have a poll now. We request you to fill this poll, which will now pop up on your screen. So we request you to please select your answer. The question is, does this sound familiar? The interaction which happened in the sketch, have you also encountered this? Has it happened to you before? Option one is yes, and option two is no. Please do take out the next 30 seconds to click on yes or no according to your experience. Thank you so much for taking this poll.
As you can see on your screen, 96% of you think that...
Sorry, Shravya, we lost you there for a bit. Let me just take it up from here. So as you can see on the screen, a whopping 96% of you have replied yes, stating that the situation, you have faced the situation in the past, you know, donors are unwilling to donate now, and there is some difficulty in obtaining donations. And a very, like a short 4% of you have said that you have not experienced the situation before. So let's just move ahead and understand what exactly is the situation. So it's actually very clear from the poll that most of you have experienced something known as donor fatigue. So we need to, let's just go ahead now and understand what is donor fatigue so that we will be able to better combat it and learn how to overcome it. I think this is a very apt picture here where the donors are telling us that, you know, no more donation requests, please, because a kind of fatigue has set in, a kind of numbness has set in amongst the donors. So donor fatigue is essentially diminishing donations. So these people have donated to you many times in the past, but now when you reach out to them, it kind of seems that they are not reacting to your call of action. It seems that they're not responding to you. So diminishing donations is one of the main characteristics of donor fatigue. Then there's a lack of response. The NGO will feel that, oh God, I'm reaching out to this donor so many times, but somehow it feels that there is no response from them. The donor can also experience something known as compassion fatigue. COVID is a very good example for this, because the donor might feel that there are so many organizations, there are so many causes, especially because of the COVID pandemic, and the donor might feel that, okay, I have donated a lot already, so why should I donate more? So a sort of compassion fatigue would have set in with the donor. And that because of the pandemic and because of the rise in causes, the donor might also experience information overload. It might appear that we have been reaching out to them constantly, and the donor might not be able to process the information, leading to a lack of response. And from an NGO perspective, you will feel that there is some sort of a numbness, there is some sort of an apathy which is set in with the donor. And this will result in the donor being very unresponsive. So these 6 points are the main characteristics of donor fatigue. So bottom line is, the NGO, that is all of us, we feel like the donors do not care and the donors are not donating, although they have donated many times in the past. So you kind of feel that the donors are not responding to your requests. So this is donor fatigue. Now over to my colleague Shravya, who will explain as to what are the causes of donor fatigue.
So most of us have encountered donor fatigue at some point. So we all know that it is a very real problem. But there is also a lot of research that says that donor fatigue is actually caused by the nonprofits themselves. Now, don't worry, because this is good news. You can understand what is causing it and prevent it. I'd like to focus on 4 different points here as to what is causing donor fatigue and how you can go about preventing it. The first thing here has to do with building a relationship with your donors. Usually, we tend to send a common email to donors, our recurring donors, people who have simply subscribed to our newsletters on our websites, and our volunteers. We don't invest the time and effort into segmenting this database and figuring out how we can send personalized communication. This can be as simple as using a mass mailing software that addresses each person by name, but it can also mention your significant donors in newsletters and in your social media posts. Now, unless a donor has specifically mentioned that they would like to remain anonymous, people usually like feeling appreciated for the things that they do. So mentioning your donors and appreciating them will always be good. Now, once you have built a relationship with your donor, the second thing that we do is failing to close the loop of communication. Once a donor has donated, they might end up forgetting about the donation or your organization unless they hear back from you. The next time that they hear you shouldn't be when you are raising funds again. Show them what you have accomplished in the meanwhile. Show them what has happened to their money and the impact that you have created. The third thing is overwhelming your donors with a sense of urgency. If every email and message that your donor receives from you is marked urgent, or it's a request for funds, or it is a sad story that is aimed at pulling on the heartstrings of the donor, they will feel overwhelmed and they will eventually tune out your communications. Look at changing your ask. Every time that you ask for a donation, make sure that it is a unique ask. Ask yourself, what can your donor do for you besides donate? Can they be volunteers? Can they raise funds for you? Can they reach out to their social circles and become fundraisers? These are questions that you must ask yourself. Now, in what we must do to counter this, I would like to show you an example from Cuddles Foundation. So there was a situation where Cuddles Foundation created a campaign to raise funds for a birthday celebration. This was for an 8-year-old Niaz who was fighting lymphocytic leukemia, and the donor who was in charge of his care created a birthday fundraiser to make the birthday a success. And they sent out an email to all of their donors asking for funds, and later even followed up with them to tell them how the birthday party had gone. So this is a positive thing. This is a birthday celebration, and this also manages to close the loop of communication. Now, moving on to the next part, we would like to deal with how COVID has impacted donor fatigue in specific.
Well, COVID has been the most, the word that is popping into all of our daily communications multiple times throughout the past few months. So it does seem that like COVID has increased donor fatigue, because of the sheer number of organizations who are seeking donations for a very, very pertinent and a very necessary cause, which is the pandemic. So it is understandable that the donors will feel exhausted, or it is understandable that the donors will feel like they're not able to contribute more to the organizations of, your causes and your fundraisers. So the question is, has COVID-19 increased donor fatigue? So before we jump into the next segment to understand whether it is increased or not, so let us just, we would love to hear from you as to what are your thoughts. So let's just have a poll now, because we want to understand, what do you think? Do you think that COVID has increased donor fatigue? So please do take the next 30 seconds in order to fill the poll, which will pop up on your screen now. The question is, do you think the COVID-19 pandemic has increased donor fatigue? Option one is yes, and option two is no. I think polls are a very lovely way to make a webinar interesting. And as the entire NGO Plus webinar is, the focus of the NGO Plus webinar is NGOs, and we would love to hear as to what you think so that we can understand how to help you better. Thank you so much for filling the poll. So as you can see, a whopping 83% of you have answered that COVID-19 pandemic has increased donor fatigue, and due to which you are facing difficulties in gathering more donations. But another interesting aspect is 17% of you have replied that COVID-19 has not increased donor fatigue, which means that there is no effect on COVID-19 on donations and fundraising abilities. With this in mind, let's just move on to the next bit. But however, keep the poll answers in mind. But we would like to put ahead a viewpoint that while it does seem like COVID-19 has increased donor fatigue, but however, that need not be the case. And the NGO can easily combat and overcome the donor fatigue, which seems to have set in, by following the many steps which we bring in from this webinar. So handing over this to my colleague Shravya now.
Okay, thank you, Mehta. So exactly this, that we feel that donor fatigue has increased due to COVID. So a question that we hear often nowadays is, how do we rebuild our donor base? We have exhausted our donor base, what do we do now? This is something that we hear very often. The answer to this is to change your perspective towards this entire process, towards donor engagement and building relationships with donors. This is not a one-time transaction. There's another person who reads the email or the message that you send out. If you were in the donor's position, would this email, message, or social media post make you donate? This is a question to ask yourself before you send out any communication. Nonprofits can combat donor fatigue. We look at something called the happy medium. This has to do with the optimal level of empathy that a donor should seek to invoke in their, that an NGO should seek to invoke in their donors. Usually, we think that more communication is always good. So we send out too many reminders, we post too much, but this isn't necessary. Means that when you are telling a donor about your problem, about a problem that you are trying to tackle, and you are asking for their help, the problem should make them uncomfortable enough to want to donate, but not so uncomfortable that they will avoid this altogether. So you must show them an achievable
apologies. I think my colleague Shravya is facing some technical issues, so I'll just be pitching in here. So as Shravya was saying, it is very important to find the optimal range of empathy. So there is research to say that there is one particular, you know, there's an optimum level of emotions that you can reach out to, which is called the happy medium. So it is very important to not overwhelm the donors. For example, the few points which you can keep in mind in order to, you know, optimally communicate to the donors is, the very first point is, don't sensationalize and present facts. It is very important to ensure that you're balanced in your communications, but also while presenting facts, but do reach out to that particular empathy in donors without overdoing it and without overwhelming the donors when they read your message. For example, if every message that you send to the donor is marked urgent, then the donor might feel that, okay, all the messages which are coming to me is urgent. So you're not, if all of your messages are uniformly marked urgent, then the donor will not be able to distinguish as to what is a truly urgent message and what is a non-urgent message. So please don't sensationalize your asks, but it's very important to just present facts, be balanced. Then the second point is to provide context. Instead of just, you know, reaching out to the donors in a very blanket form or just mass mailing, do provide context as to why you're seeking funds from the donors. What is the cause that the donors will be helping, and how the donors' contribution will actually end up changing a life. So provide context so that the donors will be able to understand better. Next, you need to depict the impact positively. From a donor's perspective, a donor will only donate to something if he or she sees that there is an impact which is being caused. So always be hopeful in your messages, you know, stating that this contribution from the donors actually has the power to change society, has the power to impact a life, and has the power to bring in a much needed change. So be very positive and do tell the donor as to how their contribution is actually helping. And they are a part of changing the cause, and they're a part of bringing impact. And the last point here is to focus on the solution. Even in your asks, do not make it very gloomy. Do not make it very, very negative. But however, do put in hope there to state as to how this situation can actually be overcome. The cause that you're fighting for can be won through the donor's help. My colleague Shravya will actually take us through an example here to understand the happy medium.
Thank you, Meeta. So a great example for this is this campaign by Green Soul called Souls to Souls. Now, this campaign is presenting a very achievable goal. They are simply asking for a donation of $199. And there are two benefits to this that
right. So the example here is, if you look at this messaging by Green Soul, right? So they are being very balanced in their communication, and they are being very clear as to what is the impact that has been caused by their organization. And their call for action is also very clear, because they're saying to support us, sponsor a pair now for the people in need at ₹199. So if you can see here, the costing is also very clear. And they also have depicted a positive message saying as to what is the impact that has been caused. So the donor will feel like the donation that he or she is making is actually resulting in a positive change. So this is a very good example of communicating optimally in order to hit the happy medium. Now, moving on to the next bit of the presentation, which is how to overcome donor fatigue. So through the upcoming slides, we are going to present some tips and tricks to you using which you can combat donor fatigue. Now, one of the most primal and the most important step in combating donor fatigue is to understand your donor base. So every NGO has its donors. So these donors can be categorized into existing donors and potential donors. Existing donors are the donors who are currently donating to your organization, and potential donors are the donors who can or who have the potential to donate to your organization in the future. So look at your donor base, look at your database, and try to bifurcate your donors and try to understand the patterns with the donors. Now, we're going to give you some steps as to how to increase your donor base. So before jumping into increase, you will be able to increase your donor base only if and when you have understood your donor base. So understanding donor base is a very important step which will lead you to increasing your donor base. So the first step here is, again, donor segmentation. So what is donor segmentation? Donor segmentation is simply separating the whole of your donor base into smaller groups in which members share similar qualities. So regardless of the size of the nonprofit, donor segmentation is a very important strategic process, because what happens here is, when you bifurcate your donors and segment it, it will enable your organization to communicate with your donors in a very meaningful way and build healthy donor relationships because you're catering to the donor's unique desires and needs. So this will also help you to reach out to the donors during different times of the years. For example, donor category A might donate only during one particular time of the year. Donor category B might donate during another particular time of the year. So segmenting donors will actually help you understand how you can reach out to donors better. Next is peer-to-peer fundraising. Peer-to-peer fundraising is an excellent tool to increase your donor base because what happens here is individuals will create personal fundraising pages for your cause's behalf. So what happens here, the individual will share his or her page with friends, family, community members for donations. Hence the term peer-to-peer. So your supporters can actually fundraise on your behalf by reaching out into their social networks, their, their community, their reach. So you're actually, think of it like a ripple effect. So by tapping into peer-to-peer fundraising, you're not only tapping into one particular donor, but you're also reaching out to many, many, many other donors. The next step is to locate high net worth individuals. As you all know, high net worth individuals have their investable wealth, it exceeds a certain given amount. And according to research, high net worth individuals are also very amenable and, ready to donate to many charities. So you need to understand as to when high net worth individuals will donate, and also have the understanding that they will be able to donate more, and which means that their donations will be sizable. So do devise strategies, do devise communications to communicate with these high net worth individuals effectively, okay? And in a very personalized manner instead of bulk communications. Another important step to increase your donor base is to increase your board's involvement. The board members and the trustees of an NGO are so important and can play a very important role in fundraising. Encourage your board members to engage with your donors. Engagement helps with retention, and it will also take some pressure off, overworked staff. It will also add a sense of community and teamwork. This can be very simple. For example, your board members can reach out, can tell their story. Along with the organization's story, they can tell as to what motivated them to work with the NGO, what motivated them to start this NGO. This has a much, better effect to the reader. So they can tell their story, they can write thank you cards, they can make phone calls, they can send emails, they can also share on social media. So do engage with your board, do engage with your trustees to reach out to their network of connections as well. And the last step is to reactivate dormant donors. So what are dormant donors? Dormant donors are basically donors who used to give to the organization before, but for one reason or another, they have now stopped giving. So here you need to be a bit innovative and try to understand as to why these donors have become dormant. What is the reason as to why they are not donating anymore? But always remember, do not give up on your dormant donors. Because try to understand that these donors have shown interest in the organization in the past. So it is much easier to convert them into active donors. So please, you need to understand, number one, as to why these donors have become dormant. And then choose the right communication, right donor-centric communication, and personalize your communication and make it as sincere as possible. Even small things like addressing your dormant donors by their first name has a very positive impact on the donors. So instead of just focusing on money, let your dormant donors know that you care about them. Be transparent. Be genuine. Tell your dormant donors that you miss them. And let them know how much you value them. And please do let them know as to how much their contribution means to your organization. So these are some of the ways in which you can increase your donor base. Over okay. to my colleague Shravya now.
Yeah, thank you, Meera. Sorry, everyone, for the problems with the internet. Internet problems show up when you least expect them. So I hope things are clearer now. So I want to speak about donor management and how, you know, like this is where we are sort of really getting into overcoming donor fatigue. The first thing that I want to speak about here is donor reporting. Yeah. So one important thing in donor reporting is ensuring that your communication is relevant to the time that you're in. As in, if there is an event going on, all your communication during that event should reflect something related to that event. So for example, let us look at this newsletter sent out by MUN Center for Individuals with Special Needs. It is a simple newsletter and very short as well. It is a letter from the founder, so there is a personal touch to it. They have created a campaign for their 100 heroes, and they have presented all of their beneficiaries here. And they have also addressed the person that the email is going to by name. So they state simply here what they intend to do with the funds raised. And there is a simple call to action, a donate button. This is extremely timely because they send this out in time for their 100 Heroes campaign. And it also tells their donors how donating during this time is going to benefit them additionally. The next part that I would like to move on to is everything to do with newsletters. So here, I'd like to show you an example of a newsletter from Vidya and Child. This newsletter is very short and very simple. It states very clearly who the beneficiaries are. This campaign is going to educate 1,800 first-generation learners. Secondly, it also has a very clear donate now option. And it also, some of the points that have to do with, like, you know, what the newsletter must include is that it is impact focused, right? So this is focusing on what impact that they're going to create. There is a simple call to action. All of their social media is linked, and it is short and easy to understand. These are the key factors that will make a newsletter successful. The next thing that I want to go into here is, yes. Simple call to action. Yeah, the next one. Yeah, is the impact reports. So here I'd like to show you an example of Give India's impact report itself. Post the COVID fundraising, we created these graphics to represent our impact report. Here, it is not just about the statistics. There are not just numbers, though the numbers do play a very important part. Any donor who looks at this campaign and sees that 32 lakh people have been impacted and that 186 NGOs are associated with this program, they will be likely to give. So the numbers are, of course, very important. And so this shows the range of this impact created by this COVID fundraising. But it also shows, the beneficiary story. It also shows that each person who has been impacted is actually feeling the impact. So there are shorter beneficiary stories that just sort of give you a glimpse as to what these numbers mean, right? Because these numbers are huge and people are like, people might ask you what exactly is happening with each person. But these beneficiary stories sort of give you a glimpse of the details as well. The next part is beneficiary stories. So This fundraiser, wedding fundraiser from Sevalaya is a perfect example for beneficiary stories because they first sent out a wedding invite for one of their beneficiaries called Abhirami. They sent out an invite to all of their long-term donors stating that Abhirami would soon be getting married, and they invited their donors to take part in the wedding. So they made the donors feel like they are part of this big family. They're part of Abhirami's family. So they sent out an invite and asked for funds for the wedding. And once the wedding was complete, they also shared pictures of the wedding and thanked the donors, saying that because of their support, Abhirami's wedding was a grand program. So there's a personal connect here. It is very effective storytelling because the initial newsletter narrates Abhirami's story. It tells the donors how She joined Sevalaya when she was 5 years old, and how the donors had previously probably supported her education. So you can see the entire loop of communication being closed here, that, you know, the donors are feeling that this is a message of hope. Somebody that they had possibly donated to 10 years ago, or maybe they had donated 10 years ago to Abhirami's education, and now they are donating to her wedding, and now she's happy and educated, married and settled. So there is effective storytelling here and a message of hope. Right.
Moving on to the... Okay.
Yeah. Go ahead, Meera. Yeah.
Moving on to the next bit of the webinar, it is about donor engagement. So donor reporting and donor engagement are the two most important pillars of donor management. So why is engagement so important? So when you engage with a donor, you are kind of communicating to the donor that he or she is very valuable to your organization. So you're making them feel a part of your NGO, and you're not making it feel like you're just reaching out to them only when there is a need. So it is almost like they're a part of your NGO family. So there are many ways in which you can, you know, undertake donor engagement. One is social media engagement. Then you can engage the donors by having live interactions. You can engage the donors by appreciating them, by thanking them. You can engage the donors by giving them updates about your NGO. Let's look into all of these with examples in the upcoming slides. Now, social media. Social media is one of the most important and the strongest tools that is available to any NGO. So what is it that makes social media so effective and, you know, vital is the sheer ability of social media to reach out to people. These days, almost everyone is on all of these social media, apps. I'm sure everyone will be on WhatsApp, Facebook, YouTube. Then you have Twitter, you have LinkedIn, and there's also Skype, there's Google Plus, etc. So your updates on these social media apps will essentially end up reaching all of these people. So you are essentially reaching out to a web of public. You're reaching out to the masses, and all by just sitting in the comfort of your home or office. So please do understand that social media is a very important tool to reach out to public, and it's extremely important for organizations to start using social media with that in mind. Now, how would social media engagement for an NGO look like? Now, I have some examples here, which is taken from the Instagram page of Save the Children. Now, in the very first picture, you can see that Save the Children has engaged with their donors or with the public actually in general. And here the engagement is in the form of a Q&A. They have asked a simple question: can mask wearing and social distancing weaken my child's immune system? And there's an answer here which says, no, these practices will keep your child healthy. So even though it is not, you know, Save the Children is not asking for donations here, this is just engagement. So you are tapping into the donors, you are engaging with them, you're communicating with them. So now when engagement is done effectively, what happens is that the donors will be happy. Now, happy donors means they will be able to donate when you reach out to them for donations. So always remember, donor engagement will lead to donor retention. So in order to retain your donors, it is very important for you to engage with your donors. Now, this is one example, a question and answer. Now, this is another example. So they've spoken about how life is like for children in Yemen. And here they have spoken about, a beneficiary story by Ahmad. And they've said as to how, you know, there's nothing to eat and children don't even eat anything from morning till sunset, except for some bread. So this will, you are educating the donors as to what is the ground reality, as to what is the cost, just by communicating with the donors and the public. The next bit is live interactions. Here, I have two examples. One is, we had an event, Give India tied up with Hard Rock Cafe, and we had an event where Dr. Snehal Bhagat, who is the senior project manager for Indian Cancer Society, actually went live on Instagram. So live event is where a particular individual from the NGO or a guest speaker can actually go live and can actually communicate through these apps to the entire public. So anybody who sees their videos or anybody who sees, you know, their live video, they will be more interested in the NGO, and they will actually, this is a great opportunity for the public to know as to what has been happening with the NGO. Again, here a CEO of Save the Children has created a live video and he has actually addressed the public. So live interactions is another effective way to engage. Next, and the most important bit, is donor appreciation. Make sure that you're appreciating your donors. Thank them for their donations. Even if they have not donated, thank them for listening to your cause. For example, here are some examples where, you know, we have thanked the, this is an example from Give India, and this is an example from Save the Children, where they have thanked the donors, where they have thanked the public for their help. So this will make the donors and the public feel valued. Now, moving on to the next bit, is events and festivals. So it is very important to cater to organize your fundraising campaigns according to events and festivals. So why are events and festivals so important? Well, events and festivals are a change from the usual. So instead of you reaching out to donors every day or something, if you create a campaign around, let's say, Diwali, or if you create a campaign around Christmas or Eid, it has that festive spirit, and donors will also be, you know, it is something different for the donors. So there are, what are the events and festivals that you can leverage and tap into? First one is annual events. Give India has Danutsav, and you know, there's also Giving Tuesdays, and you can also leverage all of these annual marathons which keep happening, and you can create and customize fundraisers according to these annual events. Then the next one is festivals. Well, everybody loves festivals. I personally love festivals. So when you create campaigns around festivals, you know, everybody knows the joy of Christmas, and there's this whole Christmas spirit in the air. The same thing with Diwali, Dasra, and Eid, right? So when you optimally leverage these festivals to reach the donor's heart, there is a much higher chance of them donating to your organization. Then there's also cause-based days, you know, like World Mental Health Day, Women's Day, there's Cancer Awareness Week. So all of these, when you customize your campaign, let's say on World Mental Health Day, if your NGO pertains to mental health, you can create a special campaign for this particular day. And the reach will be more because it is an internationally recognized day. The same thing with internal events. You can have Founders Day, anniversary, you know, find innovative ways to make your ask more innovative, and find innovative ways to reach out to the donors so that the donors will not feel, so that the donors will also not feel bored. The donors will also feel like there is something different, there is something innovative which is coming from the NGO. There's also volunteer engagement and collaborations which help in increasing donor base. So convert all your committed and past donors to volunteers. Get them to volunteer with your organization. Let them also understand as to how, what is it that you do? What is the impact that you do from a ground level? So once they volunteer with the organization, the chances of them, you know, connecting with the NGO is much higher. So make them champions of your cause. Then also collaborate. Collaborate with like-minded organizations to increase your reach, to reach out to more people. For example, if your reach is A, and if another organization's reach is B, when you collaborate, you will actually be reaching out to A plus B, plus all of their connections as well. So volunteers and collaborations are very effective methods to increase your reach. Over to my colleague Shravya now.
So we have now discussed a lot of things related to what causes donor fatigue and how you can prevent making these mistakes. We have shown you examples of good donor reporting, And we have discussed with you how you must leverage events that are relevant to your organization for your fundraising. But how does all of this come together? How do you plan all of this and manage all your campaigns in such a way that you are prepared well in time for every single one of them? For this, you will need to create your yearly fundraising calendar. Here, I would like to discuss a few questions that you must ask yourself before creating your fundraising calendar. You need to first ask yourself what you are raising funds for. List out all of the projects and all of the overhead costs that are associated with your projects. List out all the upcoming events that you can leverage for your fundraising. Ask your donors, ask yourself why your donors should donate to your cause. Frame your ask in such a way that you are depicting your entire story. What is your story? When do you need these funds? Ensure that you have the funds ready well in time to support your work. Plan your efforts according to this. Who are your donors? What is your area of focus? Target the different segments at different points during the year based on their giving power. How do you plan to reach your goal? Set a detailed plan of action, targets, and dates against each goal that you put on your fundraising calendar. There are a number of templates online that you can download to create your fundraising calendar. This is essentially just putting an agenda against every day. So if you would like, you can create a fundraising calendar of your own, or you can download one of these many templates and use them. Now, I would like to, sort of hear from one of the NGOs as well. So we have been telling you all of this, but we want to sort of hear from one of you as to how you manage your fundraising calendar, engage your volunteers, and how, if at all, you have dealt with donor fatigue. So I'd like to invite Shweta from Srimad Rajchandratma Tattva Trust to speak about this.
Hi, everyone. Thank you, Shravya. We've been working for the last 16 years in the fields of education, public health, women empowerment, and relief to poor. And I have been associated with this NGO for 13 years. So the way we raise funds has changed over the years, and we've seen a shift from tapping donors among our own relatives and friends to being able to now reach out to people whom we don't even know. We did experience donor fatigue a few years ago, since we tended to reach out to the same donors for our initiatives year on year. But we've been lucky to realize this quickly and find ways to work around it. So I'm going to list down some ideas quickly that worked for us and our learnings from them. Though Shravya and Medha have already covered a lot in detail of what I wanted to say, but I would still tell you what worked for us. First, the biggest reason that donor feels fatigue is that they no longer feel connected to your cause. I could probably say that this is the only reason for donor fatigue, or there should be nothing like donor fatigue. As long as you can make the donor relate to your work, they are more than willing to help. So give your donors all details of your work, how you do it, why you do it, how is it helping your beneficiaries, whether their money is being put to good use or not. If you're able to strike a chord with them, you have won them for life. So we always encourage our donors to visit us in person and see for themselves how their donation has made a difference. And donors are always, always willing to happily donate again to the same cause without going anywhere else. Second, having repeated donations from old donors is much easier than reaching out to new potential donors every time. To do this, you must always keep in touch with your donors rather than reaching out to them only when you need a donation. So you can keep them updated regularly. You can showcase your work through photos, videos, messages, and progress on the project. So every time the donor thinks of giving to anybody, you have top of the mind recall. But there's a very thin line between keeping in touch and spamming. So make sure not to cross the line. Third, if you work for multiple causes, it is a good idea to reach out to donors for a different initiative the second time. For example, if you have a donor who's donated for a child's education, you might also want to ask him to donate for medical assistance to his father. So this deepens the impact that they create on each beneficiary, thus adding more value and ownership to their donation. Fourth, timing is everything. You can time your crowdfunding campaign correctly to get better results. For example, if you need funds for educational expenses, you can start a fundraising campaign 3 to 5 months before the school starts. That is typically when parents start planning for their children as well. And if they are buying superhero water bottles for their children, they probably won't mind donating textbooks to street children also. Also, a good time for campaigns is towards the end of the accounting year when all donors are looking for tax saving options, or during festive seasons when the giving sentiment is maximum. And Give India has wonderful opportunities to reward all NGOs during these times to multiply your impact. Fifth, it is important to look before you leap. So you need to know how much fundraising you need annually. You can't just get up one morning and say, okay, I want to start crowdfunding because others are also doing it. You need to set your goals and plan your fundraising calendar based on your budget. So for example, if you require 10 lakh rupees in a year, a good plan would be to raise about 4 lakhs around March, April, another 3 lakh around October, and another 3 around January. So rather than appealing for funds every time you reach out to a donor, you have campaigns only for certain months. And if you appeal for donations throughout the years, your donors will start ignoring you. The last point I would like to mention is to nurture your volunteers. It is extremely important if you wish to reach out to a larger audience. Your volunteers are your spokesmen, and they can play a crucial role in helping you achieve your crowdfunding goals. So it is not right to call them one day and say you need to raise X amount of funds. That just won't work. Make sure all your volunteers know the cause that they are working for and are deeply connected to it. Then encourage them to reach to their network. A first-hand narration by them of the good work you do will be more convincing than any perfect email or website that you can create. On an average, every person would have at least 3 close friends, 5 acquaintances, and about 50 friends on social media. And if each of your volunteers can reach out to them, then you would easily achieve your fundraising target. To sum it up, the secret to great crowdfunding is commitment, intelligent planning, and focused effort. All of you are already doing great work, and small additions like these will make a huge difference. Keep up. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Shweta. We really appreciate you taking the time to provide us these insights. A lot of these, since they are based on your experience itself, this has been very insightful and very relevant. Thank you so much. Yeah, okay. So now we hope that this webinar has helped you, figure out plans to revamp your donor communications and use a different approach to engage with your donors. We understand that donor fatigue is very real, but the power to fight it and even prevent it is with you. The key is to looking at donor communications and donor engagement as a long-term process. This is a relationship that you aim to build and retain over the years. We hope to see the newsletters and social media posts that you create using the tips that we have discussed over this webinar. Diwali is coming up, and in a few months, Christmas and New Year as well. Now is the perfect time to plan your Diwali campaign and start planning your fundraising calendar for 2021 and even for the next 2 months. We would now like to take a couple of questions. All this while, our team has been answering questions over the chat box as well. But if anybody has any questions, please drop it in the chat box and we will take them now. Yes. Okay. So Anuradha Goswami is asking if communication is important to remove donor fatigue, will it be a good idea to involve all employees right up to the management? And to have your employees personally communicate with donors. So Anuradha, this would sort of depend on who these donors are that you are speaking of. It is always a good idea to involve all of your employees and your management to feel like they are part of this, that they are taking ownership of this entire fundraising process. But it depends. Some donors, bigger donors that the management is dealing with might be limited, the conversation might be limited there. But for employees to create their own fundraisers, for you to offer employees incentives to create their own fundraisers and reach out to their own social circles is a great idea. because you we often do not look at realize that our employees are a source of donors as well. So our employees have a social circle that they can reach out to, and incentivizing this can actually really help them help you raise your funds.
All right. So I think another important thing that you can do here is also create some sort of like a monthly giving can also happen with employees. And the employees themselves, as Shravya was saying, so they can create campaigns for your NGO and they can share it with everyone. So the employees will actually be championing your cause. They will become champions of your cause. And this will also pull in a lot of donors. And of course, employees will have firsthand information as to the impact that the NGO is doing and the various, the lives that the NGO has changed. So therefore, it's always important to hear it from the employees as well. That also can be done. So I think okay. We have received a few questions where they've asked us to repeat our, plan your yearly fundraising calendar. So Shravya will be doing that now.
Yes. So, Vikram and Bhavna are asking the yearly fundraising calendar again. There was not much on the screen here, so I will repeat what I was saying during this time. So, the first thing to do when you start planning your yearly fundraising calendar would be to ask yourself certain questions and put these answers down on paper. So, what are you raising your funds for? First, list out all the projects that will be happening this year. List out a budget for each of these projects. List out all your overhead costs to figure out what you are raising funds for. Then figure out what your upcoming events are and how you can leverage them. Events that are relevant to your cause are, of course, more impactful, and that is what you should be leveraging. Why should donors donate to your cause? So this is a question to ask yourself. Ask yourself, what is your story? And then frame your ask based on that. When do you need funds? Ensure that you have funds well in time to support your work. You have to plan your efforts according to when you will need the funds. Who are your donors? What is your area of focus? Target different segments at different points in time during the year based on their giving power. So a certain donor might be able to donate a large amount of money during Christmas or maybe at the end of the financial year. So this is something that you need to look into and figure out what during what period of time different segments of your donors have giving power. How do you plan to reach your goal? So once you have set a target for your project, you need to look at what your plan of action is. What percentage of your target you aim to reach within a certain amount of time. And you have to set dates against each of your goals. So this is mostly what we covered under plan your yearly fundraising calendar. And Shweta also added a lot of important points that could have been beneficial to all of the organizations. Let's take the next question. What software do you use to send email, or is it normally email? Okay. So you can, there are a number of softwares. You can just Google this and look it up. But one for newsletters, MailChimp, SendGrid are some good softwares to use to personalize your emails, to design your content, to design your newsletters before you send them out.
Next, I think we have another question which says, is it good to involve too many fundraisers from the same organization to get funds? This can also be done, but again, you need to strike the balance. You cannot, it is best to not overwhelm the public. It is best to not, over-sensationalize. So when you create many fundraisers, just ensure that all the fundraisers that you're creating, for example, one can be created by an employee, one can be created by a volunteer, and one can be around a festival or an event. So just, mix it all up and do create like a healthy mix, just so that it need not be the same thing that you're asking the donors. So that way you can think outside the box, that way you can get innovative with fundraising, and the donors will also feel like, okay, this is not the same thing that they're asking me, although it can be the same. Do package it in a way that the donors will, it will appeal to the donors.
Right, right. But always definitely as many fundraisers as possible is a good idea. So even if you feel like, you know, your employees might be, multiple employees are creating these same fundraisers, it still is a good idea because each of them can set a smaller target. Each of them can simply work on their social circle. So it is very dependent on the organization itself as to whether or not you choose to have fundraisers for all of your employees. But definitely, more the fundraisers, the better. Then people who come to your page to see if they would like to donate will see that you have many active supporters and that you have many active fundraisers. So that will sort of instill a confidence in them to donate as well. Venkat is asking a question. Usually we have seen during the festival time, lots of dropping of donations. How do we, okay. So Venkat, usually during festivals, there is an increase in donations, but of course that is only when you have, you know, created a campaign, especially surrounding the festival itself. You might feel that maybe there is a decline in donations at that point in time, because lots of other organizations will of course be leveraging the festival. And in case you are not doing anything actively at that point in time, it might seem that way. But during the festival, using unique ideas to a lot of, you know, like organizations that work with differently abled children have campaigns that related to creating diyas during Diwali. Now that is directly related to the festival itself and makes the donor realize that, you know, this is a Diwali campaign and they want to give to this because of that.
Also, so, Venkat, if you feel that there is, you know, during festival time, if you feel that there is declining donations, so the best thing would be to kind of understand how you're communicating with the donor. Is there a decline in donations because of the way you're communicating with the donor? So please, so just, it's best to, you know, take a step back, assess how you're communicating. Are you sending, you know, frequently urgent messages, or are you sending bulk messages instead of personalizing your communications? So, and also do use these tips and tricks for communications, you know, which was shown in the webinar. And when you weave a story, you know, which will appeal to the donors, and when you make it personal to the donors, it will, there is a much higher chance of them donating. So that way the donors will also feel that like they are valuable to the NGO.
Yes, Venkat. Yeah. So that is exactly right. So there is more competition, but so that of course requires you to plan your fundraising. So sending out your communications well in advance, planning your social media posts well in advance so that, you know, every once in a while there are communications going out related to your fundraisers will ensure that you are ahead of all of this competition. How much would the minimum salary for a fund? I don't really understand this question, so if you can elaborate a little bit. If a donor donates money through Give India, how will he get a receipt? Okay. So for any donation made on Give India, the donor automatically receives a receipt from Give India itself within 3 days after the donation. So you will not have to send any receipts to these donors. We will send the receipt out on your behalf.
Yes, I think that's a very good example here also. So Sudeep has said that how, you know, he was able to sell 11,000 diyas last week, and he still has orders of around 8,000 pending. So he was able to sell these diyas through his network and well-wishers. So this is a good example as to how, you know, Sudeep has mobilized and leveraged Diwali as a festival in order to champion his cause. Great to hear that, Sudeep.
Exactly. So planning an end-to-end campaign that is themed around these festivals is what will help you leverage festivals. Right. Any more questions? We have a couple of minutes left. So if there are any more questions, please put them in the chat box. Okay. How many communications can be sent in a month to our existing donors and not get unsubscribes? So Venkat, it is not necessary that too many communications means people are going to unsubscribe, but it also doesn't mean that you should overwhelm them. So finding that perfect balance, that will depend on your organization and the kind of communication that you're sending out. So it depends. You might be sending out, instead of sending out 10 emails during the month, probably you might send out 2 emails and send a couple of WhatsApp messages, and maybe to one some of your important donors, you might even make phone calls. The way that you reach out to your donors, by, you know, increasing the number of channels through which you reach out to your donors, you can ensure that the communication still remains fresh. And by the kind of things that you are telling them in this communication, you can ensure that the donors are not, you know, upset or that they don't unsubscribe.
How to get Vikram has asked how to get new donors.
So this is something that we discussed.
Yeah, so we discussed this in the webinar as well. So there are many ways to get new donors. One of the best ways is peer-to-peer fundraising, because what you're doing here is you're not just reaching out to your existing donors. So these people who donate to you will in turn reach out to their networks, will in turn reach out to their circles. So you're kind of increasing your donor base. The same thing with social media engagement. When you put a post on Twitter or on Facebook, etc., about your NGO, you're not just addressing your existing donors. You're kind of putting the message out there for the entire public. You know, so just ensure that you are using all of these tools effectively, and that you're also exploring many innovative ideas so that you can communicate to the public about the cause and about what your NGO is doing.
Okay, so I see that there is a question about Facebook fundraisers. Please write to us at partnership@giveindia.org and we can take that further. I'm not sure what the question is with relation to Facebook fundraisers, but any questions post this webinar can be addressed to partnership@giveindia.org. I request somebody from my team to put that address there. Yeah. There's another question here with relation to, we wish to learn more about collaborations. Will it create confusion in our donors' minds?
Collaborations actually will not create confusion in donors' mind, because when you are collaborating, you're also kind of the, you're increasing your donor base, right? Because you are collaborating with another NGO. Or it can also be just another organization. So the bifurcation will be clear, and even in your messaging and even in your communications, you can always ensure that there is clarity, which is communicated. You know, you can communicate with clarity. You can also ensure that the way your communication is placed, that the donors will not get confused. For example, when you're collaborating with another organization, you will also have your logo. You'll also have information about your NGO. And it is a collaboration is a together activity. It doesn't mean that only the other organization is doing everything. So therefore, collaboration is a very interesting way to work in a team and to reach out to other organizations. So, and that messaging can also be put forth in all your communications to avoid confusion with the donors.
Yeah. So ensuring that collaborations are mutually beneficial, and strategically creating these collaborations in such a way that you are making use of each other's, donor base without harming your own. That, of course, requires both parties to agree, and that is something that you will have to look into. Yes. Yeah. So upcoming sessions of NGO Plus, we will share emails with regard to this with all of our, or with all the POCs. So as and when we send these emails to you, we will let you know when this will happen again.
All right. So Shravya, thank you so much. And I'm thank you all for joining this webinar as well. I think we have reached our time limit, so we will have to conclude now. And please do reach out to us on partnership@giveindia.org with all your questions or any feedback, any inputs, and we'll be more than happy to address. So you can reach out to partners@giveindia.org. You can reach out to partnership@giveindia.org as well. So just to offer a conclusion here, so just remember that while donor fatigue can seem real, it's always the nonprofits themselves who have the power to prevent it. So the term donor fatigue is like a misnomer, because whenever the donors do end up pulling away from a nonprofit, it is because the nonprofits have failed to properly engage them. But the good news is that by being aware of how you're engaging with your donors and the overall experience that you're giving the donors, you can prevent donor fatigue and you can ensure that the donors do not pull away. So remember, donor engagement will equal donor retention. Thank you, thank you, thank you so much for being a part of this webinar. We are so glad that we could have you all with us. And we hope that this was an interesting session for all of you.
Thank you so much, everyone.